Richard.
Now, this is my favourite musical of all time. I love it.
In January 1966, the musical Sweet Charity opened on Broadway. It starred Gwen Verdon. Direction and choreography was by five-time Tony Award winner Bob Fosse. Sweet Charity and director Bob Fosse came to Universal together. Millions were to be spent on the production, but Bob Fosse had never before directed a motion picture. It was an awesome assignment.
Bob Fosse's style is totally different from anybody else's.
He's absolutely created a whole dimension for himself in choreography and is probably one of the most innovative choreographers of the 20th century.
I'd been fairly comfortable with stage techniques, and now I was thrust into an entirely different way of looking at things. However, the more involved I became with film, the more fascinated I became.
And when I find me some kind of life I can live...
Every time I'd look at Shirley MacLaine, who plays Sweet Charity, I'd see a circus. A circus of gaiety and hope, kindness, hurt, bewilderment. I knew that if we could get some of these qualities, we'd be okay.
I think Fosse has been influential on, you know, all film directors working with music today. I think probably because he was a choreographer, that he could shoot to the cut, and I think that the precision with regards to how it's edited is the beauty of his work.
I would guess the big spender number with the dance hall hostesses was probably the most difficult number to translate to screen time. It played well on stage, I think, because I lined the girls up along the rail and then allowed the audience to decide where they wanted to look, at which particular girl, at which particular moment. Now, the camera had to choose for them.
The minute you walked in the joint, I could see you were a man of distinction, a real big spender, good looking, so refined. Say, wouldn't you like to know what's going on in my...
You've got to be careful with Sweet Charity. You actually don't want to watch that on a rainy day because you will slit your wrists. I mean, that horrible man that she falls in love with, who cannot see the person, can only see the social kind of mishap of her being a prostitute. You just can't... Oh, come on, Shirley, leave the miserable sod. He doesn't deserve you.
About it, Belzy.
Yeah.
I love Sweet Charity because it's a classic bit of Shirley MacLaine acting. She is a dance hall hostess, but she maintains absolute innocence and vulnerability throughout it.
If they could see me now, my little dusty group, traipsing round this $1 million chicken coop.
She cannot help but fall in love with probably every man she meets, and think that he is going to be her Prince Charming and take her to that world that she wanted, which was to be married, to live in a house with a white picket fence and just, you know, cook and do the housework all day.
I think the score for Guys and Dolls is probably one of the best scores ever written for a musical.
They call you Lady Luck, but there is room for doubt. At times you have a very unladylike way of running out.
at the idea of Marlon Brando singing. But he doesn't look a wuss. He looks as tough in that as he does, you know, I don't know, Streetcar Named Desire or something.
Luck be a lady tonight. Lucky if you've ever been a lady to begin with. Luck be a lady tonight.
And he obviously can't sing, but it doesn't matter. I mean, he just oozes sex. It's, you know, no wonder the Sally Army girl couldn't resist him.
It isn't nice. A lady doesn't wander all over the room and blow on some other guy's dice.
I believe they're doing a remake in Hollywood, but something quite funny is that apparently the idea for the remake came from Vin Diesel, so they're slightly obliged to put him in it.
That part, I could bring a lot to the table.
Maybe he'll be good.
Stick with me, baby, I'm the fella you came in with. Luck be a lady. Luck be a lady. Luck be a lady tonight.
Phantom is a kind of show to reinvent your marriage to. It's very romantic, and people go to it on anniversaries and on big romantic occasions.
It's just, what's going on with these people that live in the Midlands and in the north of England who just go, I love Phantom at the Opera. Tell you what I'm going to do, I'm going to follow it around for the rest of my chuffy life. Just living their lives at coach parties.
Close your eyes, for your eyes will only tell.
One of the reasons Phantom is such a colossal success is that it's actually a terribly simple Beauty and the Beast story, you know, and we can all have an empathy with someone who falls in love with something that's out of their reach.
The Phantom sort of poured out of me. I mean, I for a long time wanted to write an out-and-out romance.
I don't know whether he wrote it kind of autobiographically in that way, but inevitably he knew how the Phantom felt.
Your eyes start a journey through a strange new world. Leave all thoughts of the...
Until I read the book, I didn't realise. I thought the Phantom of the Opera was a sort of... I mean, there'd been productions of it before, which were also rather campy and jokey. And I never thought of it as a piece for me at all.
It's Andrew writing at his best. There's a sort of quasi-operatic thing.
I think Michael Crawford did really well at the role. I mean, he made it his role, he created the role. And he wasn't a singer. You know, he was taught note for note to sing that, and the performance he eventually gave was quite amazing, actually.
People were really genuinely taken back, not just by his performance, but by the fact that Michael Crawford could do that.
Well, he's a very talented man and brought a lot of enjoyment to a lot of people. And he is a little gem that's to be cherished.
The power of the music of the night.
I remember when I first saw the show, and it was almost like a Steven Spielberg movie had come to life on stage when they go down into the catacombs and the dry ice coming down. It was electric, it was beautiful.
Chandelier that came down and crashed. I think it was going to crash through the audience.
Because the chandelier does come down very, very slowly because of health and safety. And it's a great pity. Until you go and see the show in Australia, where they don't have health and safety, and the chandelier just plummets down and stops 6 inches above the heads of the audience, who just sit there going, Christ!
I am here in such a night!
I think that Phantom of the Opera is, as a theatrical piece, pretty perfect. I mean, I don't think, again, I could do better than The Phantom.
In showbiz circles, this next musical is known as The Glums.
It's got to be up there as one of the best ever musicals. The very fact that it's run for 18 years.
There's just something so alive in every character when they open their mouths to sing, and the songs are just so beautiful.
I sit there and I cry every time I watch it.
There is a room that's full of toys. There are 100 boys and girls.
The music is timeless. Like, if you listen back to it at the very beginning, the music was amazing. Where it's still up to date now.
It's like a long, long show. I mean, when I first went to see it, I went in clean shaven, and when I left, I was like this.
The story of Les Miserables is probably well known to a vast number of people, even though they don't know that it's well known to them, because it's basically the story of the fugitive. One innocent man who is running away from the law that will never let him go.
It was the great revolutionary novel, and everyone around the world, because the world was seething with revolution in the mid-19th century, would take this as the Bible.
Les Miserables was actually really interesting because it was totally panned by the critics. They didn't like it. Yet when it got to the box office, it was a completely different result.
The word of mouth was going round and they were queuing around the block to come and see it.
The final song is Will You Join in Our Crusade? And I always used to think the standing ovation isn't really about let's clap the performers. It was about I want to stand up and bear witness. I want to say, yeah, I do feel that we live in an unjust world, and I do believe that something has got to happen.
All my life I've only been pretending.
To have lasted this long, to have been this popular in so many countries around the world, it's a phenomenon.
I love him. But only on my own.
Last night, you know, did anybody burst into song?
Buffy should not
Buffy
be
should
in
not be
anywhere near like
from
the top,
musical
because it's going to knock something else off.
I had no idea that there was a Buffy the Vampire Slayer musical.
I'm a huge Buffy fan, but I thought I just can't see this working really. It will be just a step too far and a bit too farcical.
I've got a theory that it's a demon, a dancing demon. No, something isn't right there.
It's so good, so good. And when I first heard the music, I just went, oh my God, this is a musical.
It's getting eerie, what's this cheery singing all about?
The basic premise of Once More with Feeling is what if there was a demon who got his jollies out of creating so much energy from people singing and dancing that they spontaneously combust?
What can't we face if we're together? What's in this place that we can't weather? Apocalypse.
Sarah Michelle didn't like the idea of it a lot.
She was quite afraid of using her own voice, which is understandable because she's not the best singer in the world.
We'll work it through within a minute. We have to try.
It had a human feeling, a human quality. It felt like people suddenly finding themselves singing instead of a bunch of professional singers, you know, saying, hey, let's turn this city into a barn.
I think maybe Buffy can get away with doing a musical episode because it's a subject of matter that transcends the absolutely normal anyway. Therefore, I think we can stretch ourselves to take a ride into the totally fantastical.
And they're tipping their hat to the whole genre of musicals, aren't they? You know, whether it's a pastiche or that, you know, I think it's all good news again.
What can we face if we're together?
I can't imagine going into the Queen Vic and everybody bursting into song and feeling okay about that. I think we're kind of more kitchen sink drama.
It evolved and it and it found its moment, and it was, and it stood up in its own right and did its own thing, and you know, it got legs, and it danced.
They got the mustard.
What was wonderful about the opening for me of the movie was that I was able to create the sort of mysterious beginning where you don't see her face until she actually says,
"Come on, babe, why don't we paint the town? And all that jazz, I'm gonna rouge my knees and roll my stockings down. And all that jazz."
I thought Catherine Zeta-Jones was very good and truly glamorous and beautiful, and someone who is a very good actress who understood this part very well.
Find a flask, we're playing fast and loose. And all that jazz. Right up here is where I store the juice.
I mean, she'd be good, but she was much better than I thought, because you're all sitting there waiting to criticise.
Hold on, hon, we're gonna bunny hug. I bought some aspirin down at United Drug. In case you shake a heart and want a brand new start to do that. Yeah!
What was kind of fun was the surprise element is something I didn't count on. The surprise that Renee could sing, the surprise that Richard could sing or dance, all that enhanced the momentum of the piece, which I was really thrilled by.
Richard Gere can't dance. And so when you see him, they cut around, it's like embarrassing. It's like, okay, you can't dance. All right, I believe you, stop it.
When I see her running free, keep your money, that's enough.
I think Rob Marshall did a fantastic job on the movie. What he did is put his stamp on it. To do that is all good news because it brings musicals into the 21st century.
When I think now of who is the epitome of a musical master, I think our hope lies in Rob Marshall.
I saw Chicago on stage originally with the original cast, with Gwen Verdon and Chita Rivera, and it was so specific. And so seeing the movie is interesting because everything good in the movie is literally a copy of the stage show.
By coming up with this concept, there would be two different worlds, the reality of Chicago in the 20s and then the vaudeville world of Roxy's imagination. That allowed me to keep all the numbers on a stage of some kind, so that they could be presentational, where you could sing directly to an audience. That you can't really do in a traditional musical. You have to sing just to somebody.
You can let the life you're living. You can live the life you like. You can even marry Harry, but mess around with Ike.
Thanks to some unfortunate things that have happened in our news, it's celebrity and crime seems to get more and more popular.
And it came out the same time as the O.J. Simpson case. So suddenly people were more savvy about how the press works and everything, and it was topical and it was a big hit.
Underneath it all, basically what they're saying is that if you've got enough money, you can buy your way out of anything, even a murder rap.
Its message might be that it seems more important to be famous than to be right, true, honest, or fair.
Okay, you babes of jazz, let's pick up the pace. Let's make the parties longer, let's make the skirts shorter. Let's all go to hell in a fast car and keep it hot.
I think the reason why it's still going today so strongly is the score is extraordinary. That score works.
It makes you feel good, it makes you want to move, and it just lifts your spirit.
Singing in the rain, just singing in the rain, what a glory.
The best musical ever, it just ever, is Singing in the Rain.
I don't know how many times I've seen it, and it always plucks your heartstring.
I think it's one of the best things I've ever seen.
Singing in the Rain comes on, you've got to see it. I don't care how young you are. I don't care how hip you are.
Singing in the Rain is a Hollywood movie about Hollywood, and that's what makes it so delicious, that you're able to laugh at how shallow and stupid and venal everyone is, as well as enjoy the inconceivably beautiful dance numbers.
For a filmmaker, you know, just looking at Singing in the Rain, I mean, just the sheer precision and expertise that goes into it, and that kind of classic Hollywood film was at its best at that point.
Debbie Reynolds was only 19 when she made this film, and she, you know, could hardly sing, could hardly dance, and she got such a hard time from Gene Kelly.
Good morning, we've talked the whole night through.
Good morning
to you.
The great location, brilliantly innovative choreography, all done with a wry sense of humour. It was lovely.
Gene Kelly, I mean, sexiest man. Set that behind. Oh!
An ass made of iron, no question.
Gene Kelly, for me, not only did he look good, he could carry a tune. And Singing in the Rain, I mean, it's forever.
The whole idea was to be so much in love and so ecstatic and joyous that you reverted to childhood and splashed about. Oh, you know, all kids do that, you know.
He had the flu, apparently. He was under the weather, can you imagine? But being, you know, being a trooper, he did it, and he did it superlatively.
I'm singing in the rain, just singing in the rain. What a glorious feeling, I'm happy again.
The umbrella's his partner, and the gutter, he makes the gutter part of the scene, and the rain spout and everything. He's able to animate it, and that's pure cinema.
It's one of those totally iconic songs, really, isn't it? Everyone knows it. Everyone can whistle the section to it. And everyone knows the sequence, whether they've seen the film or not.
Come on with the rain, I've a smile on my face.
So that the rain could show up on the cameras, they actually used milk in the rain so the Technicolor cameras could pick up on it.
If you have a bad day, you know, and you stick that film on and you look at that scene, I mean, it just uplifts you straight away.
You can't fail but watch that film and have a big smile on your face at the end. It's brilliant, brilliant, brilliant.
Dancing and singing in the rain.
Gene Kelly, one of the greatest stars of the musical, whether dancing with Debbie Reynolds, Tom and Jerry, or Olivia Newton-John. And that was on roller skates when he was in his 60s.